Do lumbar discs heal? How you doing? My name is Tom Willeman. I'm from Apex Orthopedic Rehab over in Wyckoff, New Jersey. We're going to talk about this topic. You know, people have asked me several times, hey, do these discs actually heal? And there's a couple definitions of healing, which we'll go through. And also at the end, we're going to give you a link in our description about some exercise that I give out commonly with people that have disc-related problems. The first thing we're going to talk about is the anatomy of the disc. So this is a disc, if we saw on the skeleton here, this little portion between these two bones, okay? And that's that right here is the inner portion. So we cut straight across there, we would see this. This is a cross section like there. So this is the outer annular rings, okay? And the center, they always refer to it as the jelly donut, the inner nuclear pulposus, okay? This is the material when we talk about bulges or types of herniation that kind of moves out, which we'll see in our slides. Moves out to the outside. And the problem is when it moves to the outside, we have nerve roots that come off the back down into our legs. And occasionally some of this material goes in and it puts pressure on these nerve roots that go down to our legs that provide a sensation. They actually provide a nerve supply to our muscles, reflexes, various things there. So that's something just to consider. But this is a normal disc without any kind of displacement right here. So one of the most common areas of disc problems, they'll name the disc by the vertebrae above and below. So we'll refer to this, as the L4 vertebrae and L5. This is the L4, L5 disc, okay? When we're talking about the L5, S1, that's the L5 disc area right here, is the L5, S1, S meaning sacrum, is this triangular bone below. So these two discs are the most common areas where you have problems, where it may affect, you'll see herniations and bulges and things like that. And that's where a lot of our wear and tear occurs. Depending on where these herniations occur, it can affect the nerve roots that come off of it. So you can see these nerve roots are coming off the side here. When you have some kind of herniation, sometimes it'll affect these nerve roots that go down into your legs. Most times on one side, sometimes on both. The first type of herniation or disc, abnormal disc movement is considered a bulge. A lot of people talk about having a lump, a bulging disc. Okay, the first stage is that inner nucleus that we showed in the diagram, you'll see up in our slide, that inner material will kind of push through and push against those annular rings, but won't actually break them. It will just kind of abnormally shift into those rings, but actually won't pierce them. And that's called a bulging disc. That's the first one of the earlier signs when you compare it to a normal disc. So that's a bulging disc. The next one is called a protrusion. Now the protrusion actually, when you see it, it's actually gonna go all the way out, but it's not gonna get outside the last ring. We're talking about those rings around the disc material that you'll see in our slide. It's getting right to the edge, but it's not going through. When it gets to that point, it starts affecting some of the nerves that are on the very outside of the disc called sinovertebral nerve. That nerve will then give you disc-related pain, sometimes referred to as discogenic pain, pain originating from the disc, okay? And that's called a protrusion. The next type is called a extrusion. The extrusion is the actual material, the inside of that disc material, the nuclear pulposus, actually gets outside the disc, and that's where they think a lot of our nerve pain comes. When you have those nerves that are coming off off the spine here, off the spinal cord, come down the leg, that extra segment and that material actually can rest onto the nerve root and can give you numbness, tingling, weakness. It can have all sorts of impact on nerve function, typically down into the legs and typically on one side, okay? So that's an extrusion, that's a little bit further out. And then the most significant one that we talk about is a sequestration. Sequestration is that nuclear material, nuclear pulposus, same thing, gets outside the rings and just doesn't get outside, it actually gets detached. It can flow around and really cause problems for nerve function down the legs. Those are folks that will say that they're very weak. It's resting on a particular nerve root level, and that's a sequestration. So when you have different types of herniation, they can happen with just slow degenerative changes. Slowly the disc loses water supply and slowly breaks down for a variety of reasons and decreases in height. And you can have various types of herniations or bulging coming from that, or it can come from a specific trauma, like a rapid movement, especially anything that incorporates, let's say, flexion and rotation. Those combined movements can be very harmful, and that can be from a trauma. When you have nerve-related pain, or they say you have a pinched nerve from a disc, it can be related to the inflammation around that disc that makes the nerves not function great. It kind of throws off the wiring. You know, think of it as like electrical impulse. That inflammation kind of squeezes it in a way, okay? Or it could be mechanical pressure on the nerve root that's pinching the nerve. And that mechanical pressure pinching on the nerve is something that responds sometimes to movement or surgery or sometimes, sometimes time, okay? But those are some of the things that will occur in that area that causes abnormal functioning down there. If you're having inflammation, that's where sometimes anti-inflammatories in theory can have an effect, whether it be cortisone, some kind of steroid, or an over-the-counter anti-inflammatory can actually reduce that inflammation, then you feel a lot better. If it's mechanical, the anti-inflammatories in theory don't work because you're looking at a physical thing resting on it, like putting my foot on something, on my foot on, let's say, a hose, a garden hose, and squeezing off that pressure, and that water doesn't get to the lower extremity, and that affects sensation, your strength. And then as that pressure is taken off, depending on the level of, you know, injury to the nerve, they'll slowly regain strength. Your sensation will come back. You won't have numbness in your feet. You won't have weakness, things like that. But those are two ways. You can have this atraumatic, where it's just degenerative, or you can have a traumatic herniation or disc dysfunction, let's call it. Okay, so there's a few different ways that can occur. So when do we get concerned about this? Well, the big concern is that if you start having what they call red flags, these are signs that you shouldn't just wait around, because a lot of these situations, disc problems can resolve in time. A lot of them will resolve within 6 to 8 weeks. Some take longer, upwards of 12 weeks to get better. But if you're noticing that you're getting progressively weaker rapidly, whether we think it's related to a disc problem or something else, you want to address that quickly, because sometimes you don't regain that strength if you're losing strength rapidly. Another example is that your gait is really off, significantly off. You're causing, you know, significant balance problems. You want to seek help right away. Within 24 to 40 hours, you want to, you know, seek some help. The other impact is sometimes these herniations and different things in the lower back can actually affect your bladder function, your bowel and bladder function. If you can't hold back the urine, you're incontinent, or you can't have a bowel movement and you're having this back pain, a sciatica, they might be connected. Okay, and they may be something, and that's something you have to seek help immediately. There's other things that are red flags. If you've had recent surgery, maybe a possibility of infection, cancer, there's other things there, but one of the big things is progressive weakness, and it really, your condition is deteriorating very rapidly. Because even when they take pressure off, they have to go in surgically and take pressure off that nerve root or remove that segment of disc material that's on the nerve, sometimes it takes a while for that to return, and sometimes if it's pinched too long, you have long-term nerve damage. You never regain that function. You never get that strength back. You never get that bowel or bladder function back. So it's very important that you make sure, if you're unsure about that, seek a doctor's appointment quickly, like an ER visit. Now realize the only time you can really see fully the disc is through an MRI. Now, a lot of people will come to me and say, I have a disc hernia, or I think I have a disc herniation, should I get an MRI? And the big question is that the big confusion is that there's a lot of people that have various level of disc herniations, especially bulging and things like that. And a large segment of those people don't have any symptoms. So you have back pain, you associate, wow, it must be because of this disc bulge or this type of herniation or extrusion. Sometimes that's not the case. That's not the pain generator. So in the early stages, when you think when you have back issues, you think it's disc issues, they don't want you to immediately get an MRI unless you have some of the red flags. They'll say, why don't we wait a little bit of time? Because going to the MRI immediately, a lot of people will see, oh wow, I have a disc herniation, where they may have had that for years. Then they get nervous and they slow down and they actually heal, they don't recover as quickly. So we don't want to jump to the MRI, because there are a large percentage, and we're talking 50-60% in some cases, of abnormalities on MRIs in people that have no history of back pain or sciatica. So we got to be careful about requesting it too aggressively. And really putting all our weight just in the MRI results. Okay, so realize there are a segment of population that have these herniations on MRI and have never had back pain or trauma to their back. So keep that in mind if you're advocating for your doctor to get MRI with a concern about a disc. At a certain point, you may need to take that next step, but not in the early stage, especially the first 6 to 8 weeks. So what helps a disc heal? Let's say we have, you know, we talked about this earlier, you know, do discs heal? What helps you start healing is some of the basics. You know, for a lot of different problems in your life, health problems, a lot of these same things apply. A healthy diet, you know, good at being good about your hydration, trying to maintain a good sleep regimen, getting good 7-8 hours of sleep for recovery, really setting the framework for healing. As far as movement, things like physical therapy or chiropractic sometimes are helpful in the stages just to help get some motion, help kind of facilitate and kind of shorten that recovery period at times. It doesn't apply to everyone. Some people can't tolerate therapy or chiropractic. It tends to irritate that area, especially if there's a lot of inflammation around that disc that's trying to heal. People that are smokers, the smoking really affects the healing of those small vessels that go to the disc segments. So smokers especially, we really want to make sure if you are smoking to stop and realize it may allow that disc to take a longer time or not heal. So you want to kind of consider that. What a great moment. You want to be inspired to get better, you know, stopping smoking will help a lot of things, hopefully the disc as well. A good healthy diet, a diet that's not high in inflammatory like type foods, so you can kind of let that inflammation drop down. Other things you can do is just keep moving, you know, don't shut down. You want to, after the first 2-3 days, if you have a suspected disc problem, you want to get moving as much as you can tolerate it. Just because you have some pain doesn't mean you should stop moving. Low level pain that doesn't get worse, I want you to encourage people to move a little bit. Avoiding static postures is another thing. We don't want you sitting too long, driving too long. We want to get you up and moving. We want to be, I always say, a little ADD. We want to, you know, sit to stand, sit, kind of move around. And there's nothing wrong with sitting. Just sitting too long or standing too long isn't great for you. So those standing desks for people that are trapped at home on your Zoom meetings are a great option. It's just kind of constantly changing your position is typically helpful. Okay. Sometimes using some lower back roll, kind of the position your spine, almost like a splint for your wrist if you've hurt your wrist. Using a lower back roll puts everything in a better position, but it's a short-term solution. Long-term, we want to get you moving and trying different positions and shapes and as you sit, but we don't want to sit too long or stand too long. So that's a big thing. I'll tell people, don't sit more than 15 minutes. Some people, even 5 or 10 minutes, they have to kind of keep up moving and changing position. Another great solution is a good walking program. Little bitty walks too. You don't have to do like full walks of like 20 to 30 minutes. That's the goal for the day. If you can tolerate it, do like, you know, 5 or 10 minute walk in the morning, 5 or 10 minute lunch, and then in the evening, just kind of getting that 30 minutes of movement per day. Those are really important as far as the overall recovery. And lastly, you know, there's some common exercises they give with people that have disc herniations or disc problems that you can see in the description. There's a whole video that I have for you that you can look at for McKenzie exercises for lower back pain and sciatica, and you'll take a look at that. None of these exercises should make it feel worse. If you're unsure, obviously getting a good evaluation from a doctor or physical therapist would be very important, but they should never make your condition worse. So do lumbar discs heal? Yes, they do heal in the sense that you don't have symptoms. You may not have weakness anymore, or pain, or tingling, or just general lower back pain. But in the sense that whether it's healed, yes, you are pain-free, typically within 6 to 8 weeks, upwards of 12 weeks. You no longer have symptoms, and sometimes it's just time. You don't even get professional care or anything like that. We cited some of the things you can do to start feeling better, but sometimes it's simply time. One thing is not to have pain. The second part, actually not having a herniation anymore, can take longer. It can take upwards of a year. And they've done MRIs after a year and shown a lot of these big herniations go away. And they think it's the body's immune system attacking it and breaking it down. And then after a time, it's no longer apparent. The only mystery is we don't know exactly the quality of the disc that's still remaining. We don't know how much of the trauma was to that disc and how stable it is. You know, the disc acts like a shock absorber. It guides it, provides stability to the spine, and you probably lost a degree of that after that initial herniation. We just don't know how much, okay? Over time, you'll see they lose a little bit of disc height as you have less water content in that disc, and you can develop other problems around that area that can contribute to a second episode or third episode of lower back pain. And that's one of the big risk factors. If you've had a episode of back problems, you're most likely going to have another one, and the next one's going to be a little more significant. So we want to address it as much as we can in the early stages and get into good healthy habits. Listen, I hope this helped you out. Hit the subscribe button, turn on your notifications so you know the next time we do a video, and like this if you liked it. All right, have a great day.